Right. Well, welcome everybody, and thank you for joining us for one of the final sessions of AWS Reinforce. We're honored, of course. We know that every time, at these kinds of conferences, the best to save for last, and so we're honored that Reinforce has put us in this spot just before we break for the food trucks, and I heard somebody out there singing some Guns N' Roses, and so we know there's some excitement coming shortly after this presentation. We have a fairly short presentation here, so we'll get you on your way. But my name is Jim Armstrong. I run the product marketing organization at Snyk. I've been with Snyk for about 3.5 years now. I was at Docker before that, and at VMware before that. But this isn't about me. This is really about Okta and how they run container security and how they use Snyk. So I've got Zahir with me, who's from Okta. I'll let him introduce himself.
Hey, I'm Zahir Jarjura. I'm a staff cloud security engineer at Okta. I work on the customer identity cloud product, which many of you may know as Auth0. I've been in the tech industry for about 10 years now, and I feel like I've done a bit of everything, from systems engineering to corporate security, and for the last 4 years or so, I've been in cloud infrastructure security.
Yeah, I think Okta is one of those companies that probably most people are extremely familiar with. Probably most of you either use Okta today at your organization or you log into some other service that uses Okta. And so most people are probably familiar with what Okta does. But what we want to dive in today is a bit about their architecture. They have a really neat architecture for how they deploy things to AWS in a very automated fashion. A lot of those things are containerized, running on EKS, so really exciting kind of architecture that scales to support thousands of deployments if they need to, all containerized. And of course, a big part of that is making sure that for developers, it's simple enough that they can do this very easily and do it very quickly and do it in a repeatable fashion. Part of simplifying that includes simplifying the security process as well, and that's what we're going to spend a lot of time in. Pretty much all of our time today talking about is simplifying that security process that they have. And specifically, we're going to talk a lot about container security in this session. All of this architecture that we'll dive into here in a little bit is containerized. And like I said, it's running on EKS. So we'll talk about how they handle container security and how they sort of abstract that and make it simple for developers to deploy these applications and ensure that they're secure. And a little bit about the future plans, what they're doing and thinking about for the future at Okta to make container security even simpler, to make it simpler for developers and make it simpler for the security team as well to handle this and scale up the container security. And I'll talk a little bit about what Snyk is doing and some of the things that we've done in our product to help make that simpler as well. So that's our plan for today. When it comes to people using Snyk, I know a lot of our customers want to have choice as to how they use Snyk. It's a SaaS, just like Okta and Auth0 are a SaaS service, but a lot of people want to have it in a particular region of the world, or they want to have a private instance, and you've got customers who ask for the same thing at Auth0 as well. What are some of the other reasons that customers look for your service to be sort of a private instance?
Yeah, so there are a number of reasons in addition to those few that you mentioned. We offer greater performance guarantees above what we could offer for our public cloud deployments when it comes to throughput. And then you also have the added benefits and peace of mind of having your own isolated infrastructure dedicated to only your use case. And of course, customers like the fact that they could have a private link back to their own VPC so they can keep their Auth0 traffic off the public internet.
And I think that's a really popular option, right? I know a lot of people do use the SaaS service, but the private service is really popular as well, right? Hundreds or thousands of these things can be deployed very quickly.
Yeah, it's really popular. So obviously that means it, it all has to be automated. We've set it up so that new environments can be provisioned for customers on the fly. This is a really simple diagram of the architecture, but the main thing for today is that the Auth0 app components are all containerized and running on EKS when customers choose AWS. And for me and my team, that means that we need to help our developers keep their containers secure.
Yeah, and one thing I'll say too, there's a great blog in the resources at the end, there's a great blog that the Auth0 team has authored that talks about this architecture in detail and how they automate all of this, right? So there's a control plane in the middle that, you know, that handles all of these different deployments. And, you know, anytime a new customer signs up, it's very, you know, you fill out a form basically, and you can get one of these things deployed very quickly. So it's great from an operational standpoint, but again, obviously we want to make that as simple as possible for developers to handle all of that as well. Now, like I mentioned at the beginning, I used to work at Docker, and you know, very familiar with a lot of people trying to secure containers. Everybody that's scanned containers before has probably seen the list of vulnerabilities that comes up with containers. A lot of folks, this was, you know, 2 or 3 years ago, hopefully most folks have sort of advanced their action plans. But a lot of folks I still see have a plan where they scan a container, they check a box and say, okay, we scanned a container, and we'll just hope and pray that the next time we build the container, some of those vulnerabilities will go away. Maybe Docker or Red Hat or AWS or whoever supplies sort of our foundational images will just fix things, and they'll just magically disappear the next time we build our image and we ship it off. But I know at Auth0, you're a little bit more sophisticated than this plan, and you're doing more work to sort of keep those containerized apps secure. To kind of explain a little bit about how you go about it today.
Sure, and it's not just about security. We want to abstract away complexity for our developers anywhere we can. So to start with, deployments are abstractions on top of EKS. Developers just modify the deployment details in YAML, and our control plane actually takes care of everything else. The Dockerfile details, Kubernetes YAML, Terraform configurations, et cetera, all that is taken care of under the hood.
So you essentially have a platform team that sort of takes care of all this, right? They set up all the basics and the templates and all this for happen, so it's automatic for all the developers.
Right, yeah, it's super awesome. It's a one-stop shop for anything that we would have to do in the platform. It makes it really easy to deploy new environments or services. And then, you know, we of course also need to simplify and abstract security for our developers and for our security team, especially for containerization at our scale. I don't know if you've ever heard the story of how they maintain the Golden Gate Bridge. You know, they got to keep a coat of paint on it, to prevent rust and stuff like that from all the salt water that's around it. I always thought it was true. Somebody told it to me when I was a kid, but it turns out that it's just a myth. But I'll tell it anyways because it fits in really well with what we're talking about. So they say that they start painting from one side, and then by the time they get to the other side of the bridge, they just turn around and start painting in the other direction. So they're always playing catch up, and it used to be a little bit like that for us. We were definitely doing more than what you describe, but still a lot of the work had been manual and fell on the security team. We would go through the scan results, figure out if the container is still running in production, we'd assess the vulnerabilities, figure out how severe they are, and if the vulnerabilities were critical or high and the container was still running in production, we'd cut tickets for developers to fix it. It still took a lot of manual research and effort for the developers, and of course, us as the security team, we'd have to go back and then verify those fixes. So the goal is to have a single-click PR that takes care of all the critical and high-severity issues in our most important images. We want to automate as much as possible, so instead of playing catch-up, we can stay ahead. We also need accurate reporting for our compliance teams and for our executives.
Yeah, and I think reporting is another one of those things too, where, if you're doing all this manual, I imagine the reporting is terrible is the way to say it.
Yeah, well, just like everything else, it was unfortunately manual, spreadsheets and screenshots, basically. It took a lot of time that was better spent on more important things. So here's where we are today. Images are added to Snyk when a new version of the abstraction platform release manifest is committed. You know, Snyk obviously scans the images and then surfaces any vulnerabilities. From there, the data about the images and the vulnerabilities is pulled into our centralized asset management system. Then we have a job that enriches all the image and vulnerability data in the asset management system with a bunch of, different information, such as where the images are running, and an image source code URL.
So this is pretty complex, right? Because I think what you're doing is you're essentially looking at your deployment pipelines, you figure out where something's deployed, the fact that it is actually deployed and running right now, and mapping that location as well. And then also going the other direction and mapping back to the source code repo so that you have that ability to connect the dots from sort of the source of this to its destination and the fact that right now it's actually running and you can track down all those code owners. That's a pretty tough and complex things to do.
Right, so all this information is available in one way or another in the control plane. So the enrichment job just asks the control plane for all these bits and pieces, and then it puts it together in the asset management system. And this makes it really easy to, you know, have just like a view of all of our images, any vulnerabilities they might have, what environments might be affected, and who the owners are. And then tickets are open for the vulnerabilities using the owners of the image's GitHub repo to find the right assignee. And then the responsible team will patch any of the vulnerabilities that are assigned to them. Once that is done, there is a reconciler that will actually bump the image version in the release manifest based on the latest image pushed to the registry. So like as a developer, you know, you fix something, you push a new image, it will actually just update that in the release manifest. So then the next time a deploy runs, the images are deployed, and then the cycle will, you know, start all over again. They get added to Snyk, they get scanned, and then, you know, everything else happens. So, you know, we talked a little bit about where we are today, and now I want to look a little bit into the future. So this is going to sound pretty cliche, but we want to add more scanning left during the build and the promotion to prod stages. This way, we are actually preventing the vulnerable images from being deployed in the first place, not just, you know, doing what the Golden Gate Bridge folks are doing and, you know, playing catch up and just being reactive to what's already deployed in production. So basically, we want to fix the hole in the boat instead of just bailing out water, so to speak. We already maintain a set of preferred golden base images for our developers. These are, you know, transparent to them, maintained behind the scenes. They're part of that build and like the control plane that we mentioned earlier. This means that many of the running images share common layers. So ideally, we would like to automate as much of the patching as possible for simple changes as we start seeing patterns in the vulnerabilities, such as, you know, bumping a base image version or a package version, for example. We have a ton of image scan results, but really we only have about 600 or so unique images, and those results relate to different older tags for those images. And then instead of seeing the same vulnerability reported over and over for every image, we want to identify these build patterns and common layers. Then we can fix the issue in the shared base. Automation can open a PR to the proper repo based on that image source code URL that we mentioned earlier that you know, is populated by that enrichment job. And then the tickets can go from, you know, asking the developers for a fix, like, hey, you have this vulnerable container, please fix it. It'll be more of just having them review a PR, test the changes, and then merge it when they're ready.
Yeah, and I think that's it's a pretty common pattern. I think I'm seeing it, you know, emerge more and more at customers where they do maintain this set of internal base images. It's one of the things that Snyk's been working. I know Okta is not using this yet, but Snyk's been working on as one of our new features is that ability to map those custom base images that you have. And the idea there is, you know, as you think about these containers being built up on top of other containers, that we can identify the previous container before it, right? And also for each of these teams, right, there's sort of the shared responsibility model. So, you know, a lot of people take something from Docker, or maybe it's from Red Hat, or maybe it's from AWS, or whoever sort of your first vendor is, but then they add their own custom stuff on top of it, common frameworks, common tools for monitoring and security and things that go into every image, and then the app team gets it. Well, the app team's responsibility isn't to worry about any of that stuff that comes before it, right? That's the platform team's responsibility, or Docker's responsibility, or somebody else, right? So why give them a report with 1,000 vulnerabilities when 999 of those have nothing to do with anything they put into the container, and nothing that it's their responsibility to fix? So with this model, essentially what the app team gets is a report that says, well, as long as you're on the most, you know, recent version of the internal base image, you're doing okay. If you're not, we'll give you a fixed PR to get you to that most recent internal base image. Now, if you add something bad to that container, then we're going to tell you about the thing that you added to the container that has a vulnerability. But as a developer, that's what's your responsibility to fix. Same for the platform team, right? Just a step before. So anything that they're adding, all those common tools and things, that's their responsibility to stay up with. And maybe they will find some things in the Docker images or the Red Hat images that they want to adjust or they want to fix. But generally speaking, most people will sort of trust Red Hat or Docker or whoever to maintain that and just grab a new image as often so that they're staying on top of those things that are coming from those vendors. But again, for the platform team, it's important to know this is the stuff you've added, the stuff you know that comes from Docker will identify. So that's what Snyk is essentially doing. Our container scanner, as part of its logic, is building up based on your own sort of custom logic here. Instead of saying there's 1,000 vulnerabilities, good luck fixing them, it's saying, you know, you're built your containers this way, and this is the part that's your responsibility. As long as the next step before you is up to date, you're good. So it also helps with exactly what you talked about, where you've got the common base image. If the problem is there, then every image that a developer builds that's on top of that is the same problem. It's just repeated over and over again. But we don't need to fix it 1,000 times. We can fix it once and then scale that fix across every image that every app team has that's out there. So we don't need to go fussing with that full list of vulnerabilities and trying to triage that and figure out which of the criticals is the most critical or the most important. All we need to focus on is that I'm following those guardrails that are coming from the platform and the security team. That are handling those other images that I'm building on top of, and then take care of my own stuff that goes into it, including the application pieces, right? Like, the container vulnerabilities are important, but really as a developer, especially in your instance, like the developers aren't doing a whole lot with the container itself. But the code that goes into the container, the packages that are part of the code, that's their responsibility as well. So we want to make sure that they know about those things in the container too. The other thing you mentioned, which is really, you know, It's pretty advanced. I think a lot of customers are thinking this way, but it's really hard to do the work of connecting all those dots, which is the ability to say, we've scanned a container, we've scanned it, you know, maybe the developer scanned it and we've got those results. Maybe we scan it in, you know, in a pipeline and we've got those results. Maybe it's built 15 times, but only one of those is deployed. Mm-hmm. And the thing that's deployed is the one that's the most important from the operational standpoint and probably from a security standpoint, because the other ones aren't going to be attacked, right? And so keeping track of that, knowing which ones are deployed, is really a complex task as well, right? And again, not just the container image, but knowing what code is inside that container image, what development team owns that code and can go fix those things. Yes, I want to know that the container has vulnerabilities, but I also want to know, like, if this app has a SQL injection vulnerability in it, or one of the packages that my developers add suddenly has a 0 day. I need to know all those things too. And I need to know if those are deployed and where they're deployed so that I can prioritize things correctly, right? And so Snyk added a new capability. We just, you know, I know it's another one that Okta's not using. We just launched it last week, but it's called Insights. And it provides exactly that. So I'm really excited to see kind of what you've built, but also kind of excited to see how this kind of stacks up and if we can augment some of that data that you have and kind of build this nice, kind of application graph so people can see from sort of source through pipelines all the way into production and then use that to prioritize and go from, you know, hundreds of thousands or tens of thousands of vulnerabilities down to just a small number that actually are impactful. So really excited about that. All right. Well, like I said, this is a short and sweet presentation. We really appreciate you joining us. Thank you, Zahir. Anything else you want to add?
No, I think you covered it all.
All right, fantastic. Well, again, we appreciate everybody joining us. I mentioned a couple of blogs that Auth0 has. Again, I've read them. They're fantastic blogs. Talks all about their infrastructure and how they do this and how they automate these deployments to do hundreds and scale up to thousands of these private cloud deployments. Also talks about how they secure that infrastructure, which I think is really useful information as well. For insights and other information about Snyk, you can go to our website. We'll be hanging out here. If you have questions, we're happy to dive in deeper. The expo hall is now closed, so we won't be there, but we're happy to answer questions here. We'll be out at the food trucks as well and happy to answer questions if you want to grab us there too. If you want to see more about Insights, it'll be going into beta here in early July. We'd love to have you kick the tires on that. If you're a Snyk customer, we're happy to get you access to that beta early, but we appreciate it. Thank you all for joining us again here at the very end of the conference. We appreciate you taking the time to do so. And I hope you enjoy. If there's one more session you're going to, have a good one. If not, we'll see you out at the food trucks and the concert and have a good rest of the evening.
Yeah, thank you.